After a period of recuperation, the subjects were instructed in the methods of combating the demonic, trained in the use of the 666 verses of the Book of Exorcisms, and equipped with the weapons of an exorcist. The two companies were then put into action on a demon-infested world on the northern fringes of the Eye of Terror. With a squad of Grey Knights held in reserve, the Exorcist Space Marines achieved a kill ratio of 97-1. Impressive under normal circumstances, but against the demonic, I'm sure you'll agree that these figures clearly indicate that the procedure is both safe and effective.
The Adeptus Astartes are a myriad arsenal, each chosen to combat specific threats to the Imperium. Molded from the genetic legacy of the Primarchs, whilst each of the Emperor's sons embodies traits for his successors to aspire to, some qualities, when taken to their extreme, can incur heavy consequences and derision. For today, we shall elucidate a successor chapter devoted to the exploitation of powers beyond the pale of material comprehension. The valiant, yet misunderstood sons of Banish, the Exorcists. During the dark era between the 35th and 36th millennium, a new breed of space marines would be crafted. Records that remain are scant, yet the tale of the so-called Dark Founding of successor chapters of the Angels of Death would live in infamy. None know the extent of how many chapters would be created from the 13th founding, yet what is known is that all were created from pure gene seed tithed by every legion of the Astartes long ago to the Adeptus Terror. Most records of such chapters would be redacted from Imperial records, with only two remaining as common knowledge: the Death Spectres and Exorcists. Ordering a classification known as the Bull Absolute upon their foundation, the High Lords of Terror denied all knowledge of the chapter's primogenitor to be known to its ranks, though none know why such secrecy would be required. Speculation persists that this mysterious founding had been initiated by order of the Emperor's Holy Inquisition, for with time, the chapter would share strong bonds with the clandestine and powerful organization. Whether created as a vainglorious experiment or to cater to a specific need of the orders is unknown. Only one fragment of evidence remains of their creation. Laurum Claylon, an Adeptus Mechanicus xenobiologist, had sent a communication to members of the Ecclesiarchy, seconded to the Ordo Malleus of the Inquisition. Leader of the delegation, Cardinal Rodrigo Nessun of the Radical Plutonian sect, had been driven mad after witnessing the casualty rate of the initiates of the chapter, and in turn fell to the clutches of the ruinous powers. Now worshipping chaos and freeing the failed aspirants, Cardinal Nessun would see to the creation of a Chaos Space Marine warband, the Swords of Epiphany. Not allowing such heresy to stain their honor, the Exorcists, once battle-ready, took to the stars, and under the command of their captain, Veon Armadel, hunted their fallen kin. Armadel's purge saw to the extinction of the Swords of Epiphany, and with the death of the corrupted Cardinal, the Exorcists had absolved themselves of sin. The records of their creation sealed away by order of the Inquisition, to preserve their new method of felling the denizens of the warp from the more puritanical elements of Imperial bureaucracy. Bequeathed a vast fleet of warships, and taking to the void of space, the Exorcists began to carve a legacy as noble and forthright warriors. Yet upon the besieged world of Totem IV, the chapter's future would be changed forever. The human colonies of the Totem system had long distinguished themselves as free-spirited, yet erstwhile servants of the Emperor. Unknowingly playing into the hands of the greater demon of Sinch, Keriath, the Shrouded, their independence laid the path for corruption, manipulation, and damnation. As the forces of Keriath invaded the system, the Exorcists would be dispatched to contain the spread of chaos. Exceedingly resilient against their opponents, the exorcist by some happenstance of genetics, or blessing of the Emperor, proved to be exceedingly effective in combating the forces of Sinch, and upon the soil of Totem IV, they would boldly advance through the enemy lines. Angering Kerioth beyond measure, the pawn of Sinch sought out the chapter master of the exorcists, Enoch Trimegistus, in an attempt to commit the entirety of its psychic might into his mind. Succumbing to the immense power of the greater demon, Enoch's possession seemingly would carry the day in the name of the Changer of Ways. Yet Enoch fought on, unwilling to lose the battle within his mind. During his struggle, Enoch saw insights pertaining to the weakness of his foe. Reaching out to the mind of his chief librarian, Goetos, the two warriors banished Kerioth from the material realm and hearkened a new era for their chapter. Plutonian spies who had infiltrated the menial ranks of the exorcists reported the occurrence to the Ordo Malleus and demanded authority to relieve command from Enoch and establish a new base of operations upon the world of Banish. Interrogating Trimegistus for solar months, Enoch proved to be free of the taint of chaos. Absolved of scrutiny and reinstated as the chapter master of his kinsmen, Enoch worked alongside the Plutonians to pursue a means to use the weapons of chaos against themselves. Imbued with the vast knowledge he had gleaned from the greater demon, Enoch saw the Inquisition's plans as crucial to combating the forces of chaos and began to instate new methods and rituals for his chapter to undertake. Partnering with the Plutonians and establishing a fortress monastery upon the soil of Banish, Enoch Trimegistus oversaw the possession of every one of his chapter's Astartes in order to replicate his own experience. Banishing the entities from his brethren, those that survived found their minds imbued with arcane knowledge and constitution enriched through tests of mental and physical fortitude. Venturing to a world to the north of the Eye of Terror, 200 Astartes of the Exorcists would fight for survival on a desolate demon-infested planet, as a squadron of the Ordo Malleus' chamber militant, the Grey Knights, stood in reserve should they prove to be necessary. Achieving a kill ratio of 97-1 against the demon hordes, their efficacy could not be denied, despite the derision of the 666th chapter. The exorcists more than ever befitted their new creed. The revelations wrought from their trials had ascended the chapter above that of typical Astartes. Following the birth of the Great Rift, the Cicatrix Maledictum across the galaxy, the need for the exorcists to combat the forces of the Immaterium has never been more pressing. Deployed far and wide across the void to quell heretical uprisings across Imperium Nihilus, their reinforcement of Primaris Space Marines could not have been timelier. The Torchbearer fleet, commanded by the Emperor's custodians, beset with concerted assaults from the forces of Chaos. The Dark Gods attempted in vain to prevent the Primaris from reaching Banish with the knowledge of the potent threat they would pose. Every Grey Shield appointed to the fleet perished in battle, delivering only the methods and technologies required of the Magi Biologus to transform the firstborn Marines of Banish. Despite providing no proof as to their claims of evolving their Astartes of the Chapter into more powerful warriors, the exorcists took to their surgeries with no thought for failure. No firstborn Marine would remain, for now the exorcists had evolved into stronger Space Marines, gifted increased capabilities to hunt the denizens of the warp and deny their fell patrons. Hailing from the feral world of Banish, within proximity to the borders of the Narasima Straits, the exorcists, though relegated to a quarantined sector of Imperial space, are not confined. Campaigning across the void, utilizing their vast fleet of free battle barges and as many as a dozen smaller void craft, the chapter must regardless return on regular occasions to refit their arsenal, replenish their numbers, and consult their vast tomes of arcane knowledge. Housing prisoners within the bowels of their fortress monastery, the Basilica Malefex, the harboring of several Ordo Malleus research facilities of the Radical Plutonians allows for interrogations of demons and heretics to be facilitated. Outfitted with training facilities, armories, and the Chapter Gene Seed stores, the Chapter must station a portion of its men to stand vigil upon Banish in order to protect their charges of the Ordo Malleus and repositories of Arcanum. Bereft of natural resources or industry, the feral world draws little attention from outside influence. The primitive human tribes descended from prospectors of the world breed hardy aspirants for induction into the chapter as neophytes. Undergoing demonic possession therapy under tight supervision, every Astartes of the Exorcist must be possessed by a demon of the warp within the Hall of Tempering of their fortress monastery, allowing their bodies to become host to the entity for 12 hours. With the aid of a demon hunter of the Ordo Malleus, the aspirant shall be exorcised. Some aspirants at this stage are too broken to become fully fledged Space Marines, their minds and bodies broken under the strain, with most requiring reconstructive surgery for the wounds they incur. Mind-wiping worthy candidates of the chapter who have staved off possession with aid from the Plutonians within the Hall of Tempering. Such neophytes train further within the Cloister of Scars training grounds. Allowed to recuperate for a time, these successful aspirants shall be taught the means to combat demons. Failed aspirants are deemed as broken ones and befall a variety of potential fates. Becoming permanently possessed, transforming into chaos spawn, or living in vegetative or even endless torment, it is the duty of the chapter to cull such wretches or reutilize them as vessels to imprison captured demonic entities. Preventing these immortal beings from returning to the Immaterium. Once caged within their prisons of flesh, the broken ones are strewn to the far corners of the galaxy, within the prison craft known as the Purgatomb. The pitch-black void craft, harboring untold numbers within its mammoth confines. Screams of agony fill the warded cells of its bowels, and conceal the devastating cost of the chapter's ascension through demonic possession therapy. Burying the slain of the chapter within the center of the cloister, battle brothers of the chapter meditate to their fallen dead, whilst the officers of the chapter preside over the outer walls within their reclusium, apothecarium, armory, and council chamber. The massive, thick blast doors leading to the chapter's librarium, guarded by sentries at all times. The records of the chapter's battles are transcribed by the chief librarian and his men, and detail the methods used to quell their demonic opponents. The air thick with a haze of incense. The vaults of the librarium are adorned with hexagrammatic wards, preventing the infiltration of the malevolent beings of the warp. Learning by heart every one of the 666 verses of the Liber Exorcismus by heart, each Space Marine of the chapter must sunder the seven seals of Salamaneth to be accepted as a worthy member of their creed. Receiving immense hatred from both Ecclesiarchy and Space Marine bodies such as the Black Templars and Space Wolves for their use of forbidden knowledge, the Exorcist's strong ties to the Inquisition counter calls for their censure or disillusion. Able to cut through the bureaucracy of the High Lords of Terror due to their alliance, their integration of Primaris Space Marines has only further strengthened their effectiveness, both politically and militarily. Deployed to war zones against any and all foes, those specialists at countering warp incursions, the Sons of Rogal Dorn do not shy away from facing Xenos threats and are adept at performing reconnaissance missions. Always one step ahead of their enemies, due to not only their intel gathering expertise, but also arcane foresight, their Scout Marines are a cut above most Astartes chapters due to their immense demands placed upon them. Present during the Badab War, Abaddon the Despoiler's 12th and 13th Black Crusades, and even the Third War for Armageddon, the chapter's battle honors and deeds made in the name of the Imperium are beyond reproach. Venerated as among only four chapters to have served during the campaigns of the Third War and 13th Black Crusade, only a fool would decry the valor of the Exorcists or openly deride their service record. For while their methods verge on the path of heresy, their actions in defending the Emperor's dominion lend further credence to their effectiveness. As a codex-compliant chapter, the Exorcists perceive the Tome of Rebute Gilliman alike to a holy text. Drawing from the iconography and conventions of the Ultramarines and their successors heavily, only a few deviations of their creed exist among the chapter. Whilst the exorcists follow the guidelines of 100 Astartes per battle company, peculiarly, the chapter exceeds the commonplace amount of 10 companies, and instead, fields 12. Their 11th and 12th companies, exclusively comprised of scout novitiates. Due to the exorcists' incredibly dangerous initiation process, the chapter requires surplus numbers to fight at full strength. Said to have a fatality rate of 80%, neophytes who have already survived the grueling process of trials, alike to other Space Marine chapters, are further dwindled from their failed possession by demonic entities. Overseen by the Master of Recruits and members of the Reclusium, though each scout can vary in their progression of training, their close monitoring and seclusion from the main battle companies prevents corruption from spreading. The chapter's 10th company, though originally their primary scout marine contingent of proven space marines, has now been eschewed with the introduction of Primaris space marines into their ranks. Now fielding Vanguard space marines, the 10th company facilitates covert operations never before attempted by the chapter, whilst the 11th and 12th companies have expanded their size to accommodate the shortfall. Forming subcults known as Orisons within their number, these esoteric cloisters of exceptional warriors are not limited to singular membership. Allowing for overlapping adherence to several Orisons, though overwhelmingly attributed to veterans of the chapter, acceptance within any of such orders is among the highest honors of the chapter. Arranging meetings within the Orison shrines housed within the Cloister of Scars at the heart of their fortress monastery, the Basilica Malefex, the libraries of secret knowledge housed within are maintained and expanded by their disciples. Regarding fledgling members as Brother Initiates and other such titles, layers of enigmatic organizational structures underpin the chapter's hierarchy. The Broken Tower cult near exclusively recruits librarians into their order, whilst other Orisons, such as the Obelisk Phalamus, caters to Devastator and Tech Marines. The most prestigious Orison, the Enochian Guard, is comprised solely of First Company veterans and is named after the prestigious Chapter Master of Legend, Enoch Trimegistus. The Shrine of Enochians, housing the most powerful lore of the chapter, whilst its doors remain open to any who wish to study or pray. Only the most venerated heroes of the chapter are permitted membership. Each member of the Enochian Guard must slay a demon in single combat to fit the requirements for membership, yet even then must be sponsored by two standing members. Limiting displays of membership to such orders, the Enochians prefer to adorn their armor with scripture of the Liber Exorcismus as a sign of their pedigree, by way of carving or wrapping long parchments around their armor. Each battle brother of the chapter must guard themselves from the machinations of both physical and spiritual assault, and as such require protection in excess of standard Space Marines. Engraving and etching sigils under their power armor and weaponry, the hexagrammatic symbols of arcane origin stave off the corrupting influence of the warp and their fell pawns. Each warrior of the chapter, bearing their stigmata of trauma from their successful exorcism of possession, each individual bears varying stains on their souls due to the innumerable forms of each unique demon exorcised from their bodies. Once leaving the halls of tempering, new initiates must come to terms with the imprint of their possessor, which can vary from paranoia if coupled with a demon of siege, or lingering bloodlust if torn from the grasp of a servant of Khorne. Carving runes into their flesh, which induce pain when in the presence of warp witchery, such icons suddenly forewarn each Astartes of impending doom. Though many of such carvings are cut deep, other potent yet smaller icons of lacerations never fully heal into scar tissue, requiring regular repurification to stave off the corrupting influence of chaos. Exorcists often exhibit eyes of a discolored pallor, with some individuals bearing scaly flesh or even small, spiny growths, which protrude from their limbs and scalp. Such anomalies are not seen as signs of corruption within the chapter, for such warp-derived mutations are a reminder of their righteous victory over the unholy powers of the warp. Though to show such signs openly to the wider Imperium would be naive, and as such, To prevent censure by inquisitorial bodies, the exorcists conceal or even replace such growths with organetics, bolstering their mental fortitude with such intimate dominion of the denizens of the Immaterium. Exorcist Astartes are difficult to corrupt using psychic manipulations. Rumored to possess arcane abilities far in excess of typical space marines, their compliance to the Codex Astartes and strict adherence to the conventions of the Librarius does not give credence to such speculation. The chapter assumes deep red armor, with veterans marking their seniority with bone-white trim and helmets. The elite first company sport black shoulder guards to symbolize their delving of the depths of pure darkness. Each Astartes marks their tactical speciality on their right pauldron, whether it be battle line, close support, fire support, veteran, or command staff. Squad markings are designated in high Gothic numerals on their right pauldron, with each company derived by the color of their trim, as outlined by the Codex Astartes. Their chapter icon of a script engraved bone-white horned skull upon a field of crimson exemplifies their duty to combat the forces of chaos, instilling fear into the hearts of mortals and demons alike. Despite their maligned reputation among the peers of the Angels of Death, the exorcists carry themselves as noble and stoic warriors. Honorable in their dealings with imperial organizations, and regarded for their calm when not engaged in battle, their intelligent and measured demeanor contrasts starkly when in the heat of battle. Intensely aggressive, even for the ranks of the most bloodthirsty Astartes, the exorcists exploit the weaknesses in enemy positions with relentless and decisive applications of force. Forever at risk of being scrutinized by the Inquisition as radicals, the exorcists must maintain a constant resolve to never invite censure and champion pragmatism above all virtues. Immune to among the most deceptive enticements of chaos, the exorcists, while capable of utilizing the weapons of their enemies, must weigh such overwhelmingly efficient battlefield victories over more mundane imperial combat doctrine and orthodoxy. Forever balancing their expertise with saving face, the chapter retains very close ties to the Inquisition in order to bargain leniency and sanction for their methods. Incredibly rational in nature, every member of the Exorcist boasts a deep understanding of forbidden knowledge of the warp and its champions, for in understanding their enemies, they are equipped to effectively slay them. Said to know wars and banishment rites by memory, despite their intense training and mastery of combating demonic foes, they are in no way comparable to the clandestine elite demon hunters, the Grey Knights. Looked down upon by their betters, the Grey Knights see the Sons of Dorn as little more than a mongrel breed, unaware of the true danger they invite into their ranks. Regardless, the chapter combats not just warp entities, but also a whole host of the Imperium's enemies across the stars, whether Xenos or heretical in nature. Their gene lineage of the Praetorian, further bolstering their incorruptible nature, their stalwart defiance to submit to the whims of the Dark Gods despite such a proud history, not even the majority of the chapter know their own heritage. Only the elite First Company are privy to their ties to their Primarch, and to conceal such secrecy, no ties exist between their primogenitor chapter, nor their numerous successors. Guarding their honored past with immense pride, the First Company exorcists are further emboldened with the knowledge of their bloodline. Incredibly adaptable and unpredictable in battle, the exorcists fight in a trance-like state whilst employing strange occult mental arts. Devoid of pain or fear, even when confronted by the most malign of forces with which the enemies of the Imperium can deploy, the exorcists' mental fortitude exceeds any comparable Space Marine chapter, with exception given to a select few, such as the Grey Knights. For while they lack the resources of the holy demon hunters of the Emperor, the exorcists remain an indomitable force of the Imperium, and continue to defend the Master of Mankind's domain from among the most devastating champions of the Immaterium. By my will, I deny thee. By my heart, I spurn thee. By my hand,
I destroy thee. Fiend of emptiness, to the void I cast thy blackened soul.
This has been a tale of the great Imperium of Man, read by the Remembrancer. Despite the noble deeds and unimpeachable war record of the Exorcists, to this day they are derided by their peers as mongrels, unworthy of the Emperor's light. These clandestine sons of Dorn must sacrifice much in order to stave off the terrors of the Void. Yet for all their struggle and torment, it is a thankless task. You too shall endure the barbs of others who remain ignorant of your plights, and even decry your actions. Just know that should you stay true to your ideals, worthy of your pain, vindication shall be forthcoming. For while duty is its own reward, stoicism in the face of defamation is a sign of a righteous soul.